before that we heard about the call, right? It's so beautifully that one statement, that's something, a take home for me, which says, we are not born to life, but we are called to life. It's such a high calling. After that call, we get a call, we need to make a choice. Okay? So as my dearest sister Irma rightly said, it is a choice that decides where our life goes. Now, as I was reflecting on this teaching, and just last week I had one or two of my friends visiting at my place, and it was afternoon now, it's so hot, right? So I was making lime juice for them, okay? And happily in my excitement, I squeezed a lot of lime, okay? And you can imagine with the amount of water I took and the lime, it was, I'm sure it would have been very, very sour, extremely sour, okay? Now I had a choice, yeah? Either I just keep it aside and then forget it, it's not happening. I'll tell them to have tea instead, let it be. But what I thought is, what I'm sure the Holy Spirit led me to do is, to add some more water into it. So automatically the sourness came down, okay? So instead of 2 glasses, 4 glasses became. I filled the whole lime juice in the jar and I brought it down, brought it out in the hall with some glasses. I said, "Ek, you have two glasses today. Enjoy yourself. It's too hot." But this is what the choice we need to take. When we have difficult situations, when we have challenging situations, when we have difficult people, challenging people, ask the Lord to bring some sweet people in your life. Ask the Lord to bring some positive people in your life. Add those people into your life. Don't waste your life trying to say, "Oh, what will I do with this sour juice?" No point. Nothing is going to change. Anastasia always says, no one is going to change. You change, right? So the best thing is, ask the Holy Spirit to bring in more loving people into your life, more positive people into your life, so that the life becomes the perfect lime juice you all would like to enjoy. Today, as we reflect on the choices we need to make, we're going to reflect on Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 to 25, okay? The entire talk is based on that. It is basically bending our life, okay? It's basically the choices we make every moment of our life so that we experience life in all its abundance. The first choice is we need to be aware that we are created to become like Christ, okay? So some lessons we need to learn from David. All of you all know about David, right? Now for some time we don't need to think all that amazing things he did, but there's something very, very beautiful things he did, okay? We need to learn this. The first lesson is God makes the choice, right? Now, was David, when Samuel went to the house, to David's house, was he somebody who was the first choice? No, but God still chose him. So whatever be in our life, the situation, you know, we might feel that we are not in the right place. We might feel we are not doing the right things, okay? But God has chosen us to be there, irrespective of anybody feels it is right or wrong, okay? Now, for example, my own life. It's been 20 years since I'm in this faith, okay? When I was baptized, definitely it was not my choice that I would come here and share God's word. But it was God's choice. When I got baptized, I just thought I would be happily married to somebody whom I love the most. And that's it. And I'll go for Mass with him every Sunday. Right? I never imagined that in his 20 years, he will bring the right people into my life. He will give me a very loving and supporting spouse and children that I may be able to share his love. Someone who didn't know Christ, someone who had no relationship with Christ, someone who thought so little about Christians, is today proclaiming God's word. Praise the Lord. So it is God's choice. There might be many who must be thinking, how come she is proclaiming? How come she just come? Who's she? Like many thought about Jesus also, right? He's a carpenter's son. What he knows? But it was God's choice. So many a times we don't realize why are we in a particular situation. But we need to remember, like David, though he was not even considered by Prophet Samuel, he was still chosen by God to be the king. So never ever doubt the choice God has made for you, for being someone's spouse, for being in someone's life, for being someone's mother, for being someone's life partner. It is God's choice. And you need to make the choice to accept God's choice. The second is, God designs the plan. We need to make a choice to believe that the good what God has started in us, He will accomplish it. We don't need to worry. We just don't need to worry. What was God's plan for David? For many years, he had to literally dodge himself, save himself from the spears of Saul, right? He had to literally live years in the caves. He had to literally suffer, run from here and there. He had 600 misfit people with whom he had to work. This was God's plan for him before he finally settled down. Many a times we feel we have so many challenges, so many hurdles coming in our life. But God is preparing us through those challenges and hurdles to take the assignment what He has planned for us. That's God's plan. So who makes the plan? Perfect. Loudly say, who makes the plan? Who executes the plan? So whom do we need to believe in? Yes. So, you know, many times we've been blessed with two beautiful daughters, okay? Now all of you all know, when you have daughters, people will say you should have son, correct? When you have son, people will say you should have daughters, okay? So there were some people used to always tell me that, you know what, God gave you daughters because He knew you wouldn't be able to manage a son, okay? But I used to always tell him, God doesn't give what you can manage. He gives all the grace and strength and energy you need. He blesses with all the strength and energy you need to what He has already given you. God doesn't make any mistakes. Okay? Always remember that. Don't say God gives each one of us what we can handle. We cannot handle anything. Let's accept that. Let's make that choice. We cannot handle anything. He gives us all the grace we need to handle the things He wants us to handle. Then God sets the schedule. Please stop setting schedules for yourself. I need to tell this to myself also. I also have always this habit of setting the schedules and then everything crumbles down. Okay? God sets the schedule. He knows when what has to be done. David was anointed when he was in his teens, but he became a king when he was 30 years. So He knows when you are ready for what. He sets the schedule. It might take time. I know waiting is the most hardest thing for all of us, isn't it? It's hard for me also. I can't stand here for 2 minutes, okay? I have to jump from here to there. It's very hard to wait on the Lord. But this is a choice we need to make, that we will wait on the Lord. God uses His word, people and circumstances to mold us. Everything, the word, the people and circumstances to mold us. This is a choice we need to make, to accept His word, to accept His people He has placed in our lives. They are not our crosses, they are precious gifts from God. How much of an annoying, irritating, whatever you call them, they are a gift from God. Okay? And we need to always accept them. We need to make a choice of accepting them the way they are. Now in Joshua chapter 3 verse 1, we'll just go home and reflect. Please, I would be very happy. Go home and read Joshua 3:1. Four things you learn from here too. How to make the right choice. Okay? The first is, act immediately. Okay, now a little bit of background I would like to share with you all. Here Joshua is taking his people to the promised land. Moses is already out of the picture. Just imagine, you know, scripture becomes very interesting when you imagine yourself with them. Okay, so now you're not in Divine Child Hall. Okay, you're with Joshua. Okay, you're with Joshua, you're following him. And Joshua, God is telling Joshua some instructions. and Joshua gets up early in the morning and acts immediately. So we have called to make a choice to act immediately in whatever God is telling us. We cannot say, okay, God, you told me, thank you. I will listen to you after 2 days, after 2 hours. No. Act immediately. The next thing is act fearlessly. Once God tells you that this is your call, this is the choice I have made for you, you make the choice to act fearlessly. Do not fear. I just met the other day somebody who said, Rupa, I got a promotion. I said, wow, congratulations. Thank you for your praise. Then I saw that she was a little sad. I said, why are you sad? It's something good. You know, something very interesting of being there as a registration, I would say in charge, I think, blessing. I get to talk to so many of you all. I just love it. I got a call yesterday at 11:30 in the night also, okay? But I just enjoy. And some of you all are touching with me on WhatsApp. And this, one of those person only had texted me, but I don't know whether I am capable of this promotion. And I'm sure everybody else also knows that I'm not good for this job. I said, what? It's a blessing. Just take it fearlessly. God has given you, everything will be taken care of. So act fearlessly. Don't think you're anything less. Acknowledge the presence of God. Acknowledge the presence of God. Wherever you go, acknowledge His presence. God told Joshua, do whatever I'm telling you, but do it immediately. Now, they had to pass the river of Jordan. Today, I have not yet gone to the Holy Land, but we will be going very soon. I have not seen, but whatever I have read, I know that today it is a settled river. Okay, no, those who would have gone may know. But it seems those days, it was always the water was on a very high level. And those people were waiting near the water. Okay, and God is telling them, when the moment the Ark of the Covenant you can see moving ahead, everyone else should follow. You and I need to worry about only the presence of God, not about our ability. If you feel there is the presence of God, please move ahead fearlessly. Make a choice. Acknowledge His presence. Tell like Moses, God, if you're not going, I don't want to go. Even if the whole world wants me to go, I will not go. So acknowledge His presence. Wherever He sends you, He has already gone ahead of you. You know, many of my team members, all of our team members also, they always make fun of me. In fact, the one who sings, she always says, whenever I go to preach somewhere and I'm not able to find the place, I always say, I have to really go round. She says, you don't have a GPS upon your phone or what? GPS on your phone or what? Can't you just check? My phone doesn't work. Actually, I don't know to use it, okay? But I feel, why should I check the GPS? Okay. What happened is, many a time I accept I've got lost. But those were the time when I've not made the choice to listen to His voice. Whenever I have told Him, Lord, please show me the way where I have to reach, I've always reached. But whenever I'm busy talking to myself and worrying about the traffic and whether I will reach there on time, I've got lost. Okay. So I have not acknowledged His presence. I know the way where I need to go after half an hour or even after 5 minutes, God has already passed through me. He is the best person to tell me where I have to go, right? Suppose you have to come to my house, okay? Will you call me or will you call Anastasia? Me, correct? I know how to reach my house. At least I know that much, okay? Okay, so acknowledge God's presence, because there is no way, no route in your life through which God has not passed in advance. He will never send you that place. And the most important thing you will see in Joshua 3:1 is, Joshua is telling his people, consecrate your life to God. Make a choice to believe that God has called you from a life of wilderness to life of abundance. Make a choice. Consecrate yourself. Consecrate every single people around you. Every single challenging people you are going to meet. The best thing is to consecrate those people. And believe that God is not going to keep me this way. He has called me for a life, from a life of wilderness to a life of abundance. Bending my life by trouble. Okay, we will always have troubles and challenges. Always. Any of you all do not have any trouble in life? You know, we always have something or the other, as Sister Maria rightly said, no? We should have our ups and downs, right? Then only we are living our life. Then only we will realize that the God of the mountain is God of the valley also. He is the same God. That's why when we experience transfiguration, we need to come down to experience Him walking with us. Okay? So whatever it is, we need to be confident that everything is planned by God. Again, the word of God is telling how to be make a choice when you are in trouble. Now I'll tell you, just 2 weeks back, okay, I was just telling Anastasia, we have not even reached, we are just reaching around 75, 80. And Anastasia is always cool about it. She is never pressurized about anything. She never said, Ari, what happened? Nothing. But I always feel, no, more of my sisters should come, okay? She always feels, you look happy only when your registrations go up. But it's something which I feel if God wants to touch, why not He should touch as many as He can? That's my zeal and enthusiasm for the Lord, okay? And I was a little bit disturbed, okay? That was a red sea I faced, maybe you can say. But what did I do? I do not fear. Okay. Somehow once I told her and she said, don't worry, you will get it. Then I realized, no, I will not be afraid. And the moment I realized that and I knelt down and I started spending more time on my knees, you won't believe my sisters. You better believe, you make a choice to believe that within 2 weeks, I'd already crossed 200. Praise the Lord. It only the Lord can do. In all your Red Sea, this is small. Once we stop worrying and decide to follow these 4 steps, we will be able to conquer all the trouble through Lord Jesus Christ. The first is, do not fear. There was a Red Sea in front of them, right? And the Lord was telling the Israelites, telling Moses to tell the Israelites that tell them not to be afraid. Because there is nothing that we can't conquer through the might of Christ. And be still. This is something which I need to keep telling myself, okay? All of us, sometimes we find it difficult to be still. Imagine those Israelites, yeah, they're standing there with Moses, there's a Red Sea, and behind there's a huge army coming. How can they be still? But Moses is telling them, be still. I don't want to be Moses, okay? I would have got beaten up. He's telling him, God is telling me, be still. It would have been so if, thank God, I was not one of the Israelites. I would have said, what, be still? I can't be still. But God expects us to be still when you're facing the most challenging times of your life. Because He wants you all to believe that I will fight your battle. The victory is yours. You enjoy. So better be still. Make a choice not to worry. Make a choice to be still. And make a choice to be watchful. I was constantly watching how the registration is going up and up and up. And every time I was constantly texting them. Okay? Because I was not like, it was not like as if I didn't care about it at all. But I was watchful because I wanted to see the miracle God is doing. Have you any time wondered, there were so many people looking at the Red Sea. How many of them must have actually seen the Red Sea being parted? Come on, it was a miracle, isn't it? Many must have got distracted like me. They would have got here and there, gone, lost it. You missed the bus. Don't miss the bus. Be watchful. Because as I told you right in the beginning, God is doing 10,000 things in a minute for you all, each one of us. And we are only aware of 2 or 3 things. So let's be watchful. And the last is be quiet. Whenever we have any problem, any challenges, just be quiet. You know, I remember this before I became a Christian, okay, when I was in college. Not that I was a very prayerful person, but I had this habit of saying, whenever I have any challenging thing to do, no, I used to say, oh God, I don't know how I'm going to do it. You know, but in this 20 years, the Lord has taught me so beautifully. Now, I just tell this, my whole dialogue has changed, okay? Now I tell, oh God, I can't wait to see how you are going to do it. Okay, that's what I said when the registration didn't happen. Then he did it quietly. So be quiet. He will do his work. Let him make all the noise. Let us be quiet. Building my life to build Christ-like character. Okay. Now, all of us would agree, we are all healed. There is no person in the entire universe who is not healed by the wounds of Christ, right? What do with our wounds and pains? Sometimes we feel, "Arey, why I am suffering? Why I am getting so much of pain? Why I am getting so much of ailments? Spiritual pain, physical pain, emotional pain. Why?" It is to bless somebody else. We will not understand. We will not understand what Renisha went through. It is not that God was trying to test you or God was trying to punish you. No, it is that she can come here and testify. She had to go through that. She had to go through. There is no choice. Today, in this 20 years of my journey, if I see all the ups and downs, I feel, yes, definitely it is for me to be a blessing to somebody else. It is for me to learn a lesson. Because our life is for others. We should stop telling like other people say, you know, if I am good, no, people will take benefit, advantage of me. Please continue to be good. In spite of all your suffering and pain, offer it to the Lord. Just the other day, one of my sisters in CFC, we had a meeting and she shared, her finger had come near the door, okay, and she was just giving some instructions to somebody. And she had kept her hand near the door and her son came and banged the door. So this finger got cut. One part of the finger literally fell down. So you can imagine the excruciating pain she was in. Okay, and she said, "Rupa, initially yesterday I just yelled. Then suddenly I realized my children are getting scared because there is blood everywhere. I just calmed myself." And she told me, "I just remembered something. We had just met the 2 days back also and I had just shared with her something. Just remembered a prayer. I said a prayer. I said, Lord, I'm offering this pain." It was during that holy days, okay? Thursday or Friday it was. "I'm offering this pain for you, Lord." And she said after that she had not experienced any pain. Praise the Lord. This is to be like Christ, to be like his character. In his excruciating pain, he asked forgiveness for all of us. And the last part is bending my life to respond like Jesus. Okay? Jesus was very clear about his mission. I always pray that, you know, we should all be focused like him. He came to give his Father's love. That's it. He didn't have any other agenda. He wanted every single soul in the entire world to know that we are the children of our Heavenly Father. And he loves us immensely. Now, we are all sisters here except a few men, okay? But we can take all ourselves as the daughters of the King, okay? We are the princess, right? So, anytime you feel low, just keep adjusting your crown. I'm the princess. Okay. Now this small hair of mine is coming out. I keep adjusting it, right? So we can adjust our crown and say, "I am not anything less. I am the daughter of God." It's okay. Let anybody think anything of me. So how do we just that's the confidence the Lord had, right? The same people who said Hosanna, Hosanna, the same people said crucify him. So, but where was his strength? He knew who he was. And we need to know who are we in Christ. This is the way we need to know. Go home and read John 10, verse 1 to 5 and verse 27. Jump, okay, to 27. You will get the 4 hours. We need to know what relationship we have with our Heavenly Father. We need to make a choice to constantly think about that relationship and believe in that relationship. We need to know that we have a reason to make a different choice. We cannot be like others. We are children of our Heavenly Father. So that's a solid reason to be a different person. And the result. We need to believe that the result is that every time I call on to my God is already there. And every time the Lord calls on to me, I make the choice to listen to His voice. And I need to respond just like Mother Mary responded. She didn't know anything. She just knew 2 things. This is the plan of God and the Holy Spirit will do it. We also need to know today, whatever situation we are in, we need to make a choice to believe that this is the plan of God and the Holy Spirit will empower. God bless you all. Have a choice-filled day. And the final thing, remember, a moment spent in the Holy Spirit can transform you. A moment spent with the Holy Spirit can transform you. But a life spent in the Holy Spirit can transform nations. So may our entire life be spent in the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit so that we can transform generations to come. God bless you.